greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
I am a former Los Angeles police narcotics detective, and I worked South Central Los Angeles, and I will tell you, Director Deutsch, and the agency has dealt drugs throughout this country for a long time.
Oppositional defiance disorder.
Schools criticized for open system.
Everywhere you look, there it is. Think psychiatry has nothing to do with you? Think again. The whole field of psychiatry has gotten into every facet of your life.
They basically believe that everyone is mentally ill.
You smoke too much, it's a disease. You're too unhappy, it's a disease. You're too thin, it's a disease. You're too fat, it's a disease.
Where are these coming from? These are coming from the minds of psychiatrists that are dreaming these things up, writing papers and getting published with their names on it, calling, creating these new diseases.
It was poison, ecstasy, coke, you say it's love, it is poison. Schools where I learned it should be burned, it is poison. Physicians prescribing us medicine, which is poison. Doctors injecting
our... Doctors here and nationwide are paid to talk up a certain company's medications to their peers.
And now we're finding out just how much some of them are getting paid. Here's Team 5's Kelly Tuthill with an exclusive tonight.
The list on Eli Lilly's public website goes on and on. Hundreds of doctors nationwide paid thousands and thousands of dollars to do what is called advising and education. Critics call it a conflict of interest, nothing more than a sales pitch.
There are salespeople with MDs after their names.
Team 5 Investigates scoured the list to find the top Massachusetts earners. Dr. Brent P. Forrester took in $50,800. Dr. Stephen C. Ellen received $50,700. Those earnings were from Eli Lilly alone in just the first 3 months of this year. The next highest earners, psychiatrist Gopinath K. Malia and Sumer D. Verma. Doctors Forrester, Malia, and Verma are all affiliated with McLean Hospital, which said this is all allowable under federal or state law.
Now an investigation that puts the medical profession under the microscope. More than a third of doctors say they've accepted free travel from drug companies, and more than a fourth say the drug companies paid them in exchange for everything from lectures to conducting clinical trials. This raises some troubling questions about possible conflicts of interest.
I went to foster care when I was 14 years old, and when I went in, I was like a shy person. I was new to the stuff that was going on around me. I was new to girls, and I was new to having other people take care of me. So I was a shy person at first, and I wasn't ready for that. And then they, as soon as I got there, they were telling me that I had to take medicine to be in that care, or I couldn't stay at that RTC. And I didn't know why I had to, but they said, well, you have to be able to take this medicine. If you don't take it, then we cannot keep you. The medicine they prescribed for me, they just not give you a little amount of doses to tell you how. They didn't give you a little bit to see how you go with. They automatically dose you to like 500 milligrams. I think they should know a kid before they just stick you on medication. And they didn't really know us. They automatically thought I was depressed because I was like a shy person. And I wasn't really depressed. I was just trying to get new of the environment I was in because I was an Austin.
After slavery was abolished, psychiatric racism not only persisted, it intensified. The American Journal of Psychiatry officially proclaimed that Negroes, as descendants of savages and cannibals, were ill-prepared for higher civilization, while their pseudo-science eugenics stepped up its racist activities.
There is a clear and long and intimate connection between the eugenics movement and the Ku Klux Klan. Harry Laughlin, who was the Carnegie Institution's director of the Eugenics Record Office, had close relationship to the Ku Klux Klan through the publication of a book called White America, which was written by a major Klan leader. So Laughlin wrote a golden review of the book in the Eugenics News. And at the same time, you have the Ku Klux Klan using eugenics to justify their racist goals.
But psychiatric racism wasn't exclusively American. Some of the worst abuses of the 20th century occurred in South Africa, where the government adopted the same racist theories and practices used by Hitler. This was no coincidence. The Prime Minister had studied eugenics as a psychology student in Nazi-influenced Germany in the 1920s.
Dr. Heinrich Verwoerd is regarded as the architect of apartheid. He saw South Africa as a divided state with whites, blacks and brown people living in totally separate areas, with black people having no rights whatsoever.
With apartheid in place, psychiatrists established mental hospitals throughout the country that were in fact nothing more than slave
concept of whiteness. If you know the history of the whole concept of the white race, where it came from and for what reason, you know that it was a trick, and it's worked brilliantly. See, prior to the mid to late 1600s in the colonies of what would become the United States, there was no such thing as the white race. Those of us of European descent did not refer to ourselves by that term really ever before then. In fact, in the old countries of Europe, we had spent most of our time killing each other. We didn't love each other. We weren't one big happy family. The side of my family that comes from Scotland, hell, they didn't even worry about fighting people outside of Scotland. Highlanders and Lowlanders just fought the hell out of each other. So there was no white race.
In 1971, in the United States, psychiatrist Louis Jolly West continued psychiatry's legacy of racism, hatching a secret aversion therapy experiment called the Violence Center. His government-funded plan: implant electrodes in the brains of African American and Hispanic males to shock them should they exhibit any violent behavior. And if that didn't work, chemically castrate them with drugs. When West's racist proposal met with public outrage, the plan was quickly shelved. Though psychiatry's unrelenting racist theories were blunted, they were not stopped. In 1994, psychologist Richard Herrnstein co-authored The Bell Curve, claiming to prove that blacks were genetically disabled and therefore inferior to whites.
Today, the chances are good your doctor accepts benefits from drug companies, and not just the free samples and the pens you see in most doctors' offices. Estimates say drug company payments to doctors go as high as $57 billion a year, covering consulting fees, speaking fees on drugs, and medical seminars on the benefits of drugs.
Ask your doctor.
Talk to your doctor.
Ask your doctor.
Which means the industry spends far more money marketing to doctors than it spends on advertising.
If they're being paid, it ought to be reported.
One senator, Charles Grassley of Iowa, is also looking at the money drug companies pay to doctors for academic research.
The numbers didn't add up when you asked for them.
The guy said it was that far apart.
Grassley is investigating some 20 top medical schools, including Harvard, Stanford, and the University of Cincinnati, for underreporting the income top researchers are getting from the drug industry. Grassley wants to learn if the money is influencing research. At Harvard, for example, Dr. Joseph Biederman, whose research has led to huge increases in bipolar diagnoses in children and the prescriptions needed to treat those children, is being asked why he allegedly failed to report $1.6 million in fees from drug companies.
What kind of flag does that raise for you?
Well, it raises a flag to me that they might have something to hide. It raises a flag that the university doesn't care.
Dr. Biederman tells CBS News some of that industry money was not personal income, and that his life's work is devoted solely to rigorous...
Newburyport psychiatrist Dan Carlatt used to be on another drug company's payroll.
That really is what it feels like when you're doing it.
One pharmaceutical company paid Carlatt $30,000 for talking to doctors about depression, highlighting a drug made by that company. On his blog, he calls it the Dirty 30, but it's nothing compared to what he says some docs pocket.
I personally know of some doctors in the business who've made upwards of $1 million a year.
And we will soon know how much all doctors...
Take this back, and this is the best part of our action plan, is to reclaim the minds of our children, because then they went into the public schools and took discipline out of there. So when we acted up in there, they put our boys, our black men, into something called special ed classes. Those special ed classes are nothing but holding cells until they can go to the state prison.